You know, my whole life, from like maybe 15 to now, I'm in my 60s. I always thought a fucking biker was Joe Badass.
Police identified this man as John Remington, a member of the Hells Angels Motorcycle Club. As you can see, he's staring down this man, Carl Justice Nordstrom, also known as CJ Norstrom. Lightning quick, two punches, and John Remington hits the deck. Heated blows on Remington. Then he stands up and kicks him several times. Police reports obtained by Target 12, Nordstrom, who is a former pro boxer.
When 220 pounds from Providence, Rhode Island, CJ Vessio.
Meanwhile, Vessio is beating up Bissonnette. Bissonnette not responding. He's just taking. And Vessio is just eating him up. Big right uppercut, a right hand. Where's the referee? Where's Martin Tabor?
Bike was my life. I bought a bike 44 years ago, and we've been getting old together. You know, outlasted my marriage and probably 60, 100 fucking broads. You know, the bike always came first. I was born and raised in California, Santa Rosa, California. Family moved here when I was probably 10, 12 years old. I had a brother-in-law that was married to my oldest sister. He was like the dad I should have had. I became a prize fighter like him, pro fighter, iron worker like him. He was a good guy. He was my main means of sanity sometimes. He always tried to guide me at a young age, like I think like 15, to get into boxing. Because I was always getting in street fights. He was always coming down to school, fucking bailing me out on a Friday with the principal, you know. That came regular for him, always trying to tell me, you know, like, fuck the motorcycles, fuck them guys you're hanging with, you know. Get into the gym. You like fighting so much. Do it the right way. Get into the fucking gym and do it with the gloves on, you know. And I just never listened. I was ended up being like 27 years old when I got serious with the fight game. I got out of school, and from school I was on the streets. I don't want to say a fresh kid, but I was just fucking wild, you know. I was nice to the older people, respectable to the older people. But when it came to clicks and hanging on the corner, I didn't give a fuck how many guys pulled up in a car. If somebody was fucking with one of my best friends, I'd put him in the fucking, I'd lock him in the fucking car and say, I'll take care of this. You know, even though it was like four against one or five against one, you know. My whole lifestyle was that way, not giving a fuck, you know.
He looked at fucking McGillis' bike and said, what's this toilet? He said, them fucking numbers don't look too healthy, right? Instead of trooper, instead of McGillis looking at the trooper, talking to the trooper, the trooper said something about the numbers. He goes like this, John. He goes, he looks right at me, right? I said, hey, you fucking asshole, what are you looking at me for? So the trooper walks away, right? When the trooper walks away, fucking bang him, right? The trooper hears the body rolling down the hill. He says, what happened to him? I says, he tripped. He fell over the guardrail. Right. Down the fucking hill he went. When he got up, he couldn't talk. He says, what's wrong with you? He said, I think my job. Hey, right. He invites us down to his town. He says, hey, it's an amusement area. Hey, John, we go down to this fucking guy's neighborhood, right? We go into one bar, there's a number of pinball machines. So Randy, Bobby, Eddie Malloy was with us. We all, you might even fucking been there that night.
That night down the beach?
Down the beach.
Yeah, down the beach.
And he said, what are you down the, he said, you like playing pinball machines? I said, this fucking pinball machine ain't even working. He said, what do you mean? I pulled it back down. I go like, I lift the fuck, break the fucking arm. I said, look, it's bent. He said, you gonna stop that shit down there? I said, hey, where's the fucking, where's the city yard down there? He said, what for? I said, I gotta get some gas. He said, we don't do that down there. I said, you do now. Open up the fucking gate.
I got in some trouble because of the motorcycle world. I got into a fucking bar and brawl back in 76. After saying to all my bikey buddies, 76, this is going to be our year, you know. We stopped in one bar in Warwick, Rhode Island. Had the owner up against the dartboard throwing fucking buck knives at him. Tried to fuck with us, so we fucked with him back, you know. But he was afraid to have us arrested, which I wish he wasn't, because we would have never went to Newport that night. We ended up going to fucking Newport. Somehow or another, a fucking wedding party was in this bar, and we didn't know it was a wedding party. We went into the fucking joint, started drinking, shooting pool. I think one of the girls that was either got married in the wedding party asked us if we were a motorcycle club. Because I had FTW on the back of my jacket. This little guy had FTW on his jacket. And because we both had the same design, this broad thought we were a motorcycle club. And she asked me some fucking stupid question like, do you guys share your women? You know? And me being a fucking wise guy, I looked at her and said she had nothing to worry about because we only do that to good-looking broads. You know, and she took it as an insult, ran over and cried to her old man that I insulted her. And the fucking guy took a look at me weighing, you know, 270 pounds, 260, didn't want to fuck with me. So he fucked with this other guy that was with me that weighed like 160. And next thing I know, he sucker shots him with a beer bottle. Then fucking all hell broke loose, you know. My first reaction was to look for my brother Danny. And my brother Danny come walking out of the men's room looking down. When he looked up, this big guy, like 250, 240, smashed him in the face with a pool stick and then stabbed him in the chest with the pool stick. That's when I think I lost. I blacked out. I didn't remember the whole fight. But I came to when we were like leaving the joint at the front door, trying to wedge the door so no one else could get out, so all my buddies and my brother could get in the fucking car, you know. And it was a bad fucking brawl, you know. A lot of people got stabbed, a lot of people got slashed with busted beer mugs, bottles. It was a night out that turned into a fucking nightmare, you know. My whole life changed because of this fucking thing, you know, this one night ride, you know. The fucking thorn in my ass for like probably 30, 40 years. Still is, you know. And nobody ever knew the real deal, you know. I was a kid hanging with some guys that were 10, 12 years older, brought up on the street, one for all for one. Even though other guys did things that we couldn't rat or say they did, you know, you end up taking a fall for somebody else's fucking bullshit. But when I went to the can, I had the attitude, I went in alone, I was leaving alone. I got out on bail, another biker that was a karate instructor, tough fucker from South Providence, became a boxer manager of mine, you know. He ended up knowing both sides of the fence. I think he worked for Buddy Cianci, a mayor that was running Providence, Rhode Island, you know, back then at the time. This guy, Bobby Aratunian, hooked me up with Don King, Al Braverman. I boxed guys like Dino Dennis, a New England champ from here in New England. He fought George Foreman, ended up sparring with guys like Ron Lyle, Larry Holmes, even Ali. Muhammad Ali became like a big player in my fight game. Changed my whole way of thinking about white and blacks, you know. Taught me everybody had two arms, two legs, and a fucking head to be busted like anybody else, you know.
The fight happened in a Bristol bar just two nights before the big 4th of July parade. The topside bar was packed with people, and police say, considering the players involved, could have been much worse. Now, police fear the Hells Angels could try and take the law into their own hands.
The topsider, it was all over my daughter. Nobody really ever knew about that neither, you know, fucking. My daughter was going to URI at the time. She was hanging with a couple of girls, or not hanging, but, you know, socializing with a couple of girls from Roger Williams College. And they mentioned out in front of the house that they'd meet at this lounge called the Topside. And I knew the Topside was a bikie hangout on a Saturday, Sunday. But I didn't know how it was at night. So I wanted to investigate, make sure it was a safe, cool joint for them to be at. So I went a couple of nights before they were supposed to meet just to check out the lounge at nighttime. A couple of buddies of mine, one from Nevada, one from Johnston, wanted to do the motorcycle ride, so they took a ride with me. My motorcycle was the only bike parked out front. The other two bikes were parked on the side of the top side. These six guys walk in, two flying colors, four prospects with them. Four guys stayed at the downstairs bar, and these other two walked up to where we were sitting. And soon enough, they weren't there 15, 20 minutes. They started the stare down tactic. The stare down tactic and spitting wine at fucking 22, 23-year-old maid. Throwing ice cubes at one another, but really hitting the barmaid. Tactics that a fucking moron would do, you know. And all I could think about is, this could be my daughter. So the more I fucking looked at him, the more irritable he got, and he made the mistake of walking up to me. And he says to me, what the fuck was I staring at? And I started laughing because I haven't defended that since like fourth or fifth grade in grammar school, you know. I think I said to him, you have to answer something for me. He says, what's that? I said, how the fuck did you get out of the house without wearing your wife's skirt? So that's when he said to me, hey, I like that. And he put his hand out to shake my hand. So I said, fuck it, I'll shake this guy's hand, you know. Now I know where his right hand is. I shook hands with him, and he tried to pull me in like the sucker shot me, you know. But I was like 400 pounds back then. When he tried to pull me in, I didn't move. He got angry and pushed me. But when he pushed me, he lined me up for a perfect fucking right hand, and I cracked him. But I didn't expect him to go down so fucking easy the way he did. I mean, this guy was out cold, right? And a friend of mine that was in the men's room at the time, he thought I, because the sound was so loud, he thought I whacked him with a fucking chair. Because, I mean, it echoed through the whole fucking bar. And once one punch is thrown, I follow through with everything, you know. Next thing I know, the fucking cops were there. And it was, you know, time to screw, so we screwed. And, but back in the 60s, 68, 69, my two older brothers had pan heads. And they were rigid frames, pan heads, high handlebars. I used to see them strut down the road. I said, man, that's what I want to do. I want to be the fucking biker. I want to be the badass biker. But the badass biker, as I got older, especially after the fucking Byron Brawl, I started thinking, saying to myself, I always thought fucking bikers were tough pricks that knew everything about motorcycles. But the real biker, he's the type of guy that could ride cross country. You know, bike breaks down, fix it himself. Guys that know what the fuck to do when their bike breaks down. You know, and they don't have long hair, beards, tattoos. These guys, not just mechanics, but they're the real bikers that can ride. I thought the badasses were the bikers, but the real fucking bikers are the guys that know everything about a fucking motorcycle and enjoy riding, you know. Not the guy that's trying to intimidate some fucking old lady or some old man in a supermarket or a fucking bar room. I can see you intimidating some fucking punk in a bar, but not some citizen that's with his wife or his girlfriend minding his own fucking business, you know. Them were the bikers I thought were fucking bikers, but they're not bikers. A real fucking biker is a guy that can hop on his fucking scoot, mind his own fucking business, and do a fucking 600-mile run during a 1 8-hour run, you know? I can go on and on about fucking the bike world.
That's good right there.
All right?
Yeah, that's good.
Georgia, Georgia, the whole day through, just an old sweet song keeps Georgia on my mind.
Georgia on my mind.
I said, Georgia, Georgia, a song of you comes as sweet and clear as moonlight through the pines. Other arms reach out to me, other eyes smile tenderly. Still in the peaceful dreams I see, the road leads back to you. I said, Georgia, oh, Georgia, no peace I find, just an old sweet song keeps Georgia on my mind.